That I had the occasion to lunch with Robin Barrington Ward, who was then the editor of the Times, and I did my best to explain to him of my experience and how I tried to explain what had taken place in Greece. He was quite impervious to anything that I had to say. He was totally and entirely sympathetic to the Eamalas position, and he thought that Churchill had gone completely off his head.
In the House of Commons, Churchill said, "There is no case in my experience, or at least wartime experience, where the British government has been so maligned and its motives so traduced in our own country by important organs of the press or among our own people." He defended his action by claiming that for 3 or 4 days or more, it was a struggle to prevent a hideous massacre in the center of Athens, in which all forms of government would have been swept away and naked, triumphant Trotskyism installed.
I suppose there must have been 40 to 50 men and women who were involved in final policy decisions on this, a dozen or so responsible British and American newspapers. They were very well informed, very intelligent, and at that moment in the war, they were enormously motivated to support Churchill's policy if they possibly could. Now, you've got two alternatives. Either one man, Churchill, was wrong on this business, or else 40 to 50 well-informed, well-motivated men and women, all at the same moment, and on the same issue, all took leave of their senses and regarded Churchill as being wrong when he was really right. Well, I mean, the saying is, you can pay your money and you can take your choice.
On December the 18th, the Royal Air Force headquarters in Athens was attacked and overrun by Elas.
2 o'clock one morning. Surrender, comrades! We were waking up much better than the alarm clock, and there were a few shouts, and there we were, I presumed, at war. We dressed, went downstairs to the where the rest of the chaps were, and more or less set about talking about what was happening. No one really knew, except that we were being fired at. And suddenly there was, like a noise, like came a Venetian blind up and down several times. They were quietly, and quiet, a little while later, bang! And the shell came up through the Venetian blinds at the window and went into the room, went over to my right, and burst in the wall, luckily. I probably wouldn't be here now.
With RAF personnel now, alas, prisoners, Churchill flew out to Greece with Eden on Christmas Eve. He met with resistance leaders and Greek government ministers for 2 days. The outcome of the meetings was that a regency was set up under Archbishop Banaskinos. Churchill was finally persuaded that the king could not return to Greece before a referendum. Meanwhile, the fighting went on. With aerial superiority, the British gained the upper hand 2 weeks later. On January the 11th, Elas met British representatives with the Greek government and signed an armistice to take effect from the 15th. Throughout the fighting, the Russians remained silent. Since July, their military mission had indicated Russia's desire not to get involved, although the Greek Communist Party knew nothing of Stalin's agreement to stay out of Greece.
The Soviet military mission didn't get involved at all in our problems. They kept a consistently neutral position to the point of suspicion. When we ask for support in arms and ammunition, the response was always, "We will report your request." But right until the end, in December, we did not receive a single Soviet bullet.
At the Yalta Conference in February 1945, Stalin reconfirmed to Churchill that he had complete confidence in British policy in Greece. Churchill replied that he was much obliged to him for his attitude in this matter.
There was a lack of political foresight among the Greek leadership. They should have seen that the two great powers
We just try and get as much for themselves as possible at the end of the war. And in that power game, our leaders should have realized that Greece would be put in the British sphere of influence.
What we can claim is that we left Greece with a free choice after the war. And this is what we aimed to leave them with. Our main purpose, that is the purpose of us as a mission with the Greek resistance, was to ensure that no armed force could seize a monopoly of power when the Germans left. And this we did indeed achieve, and this, I think, is why Greece is a parliamentary democracy today, and not just another East European puppet state behind the Iron Curtain.
I don't think the December events were a revolution. December was really a resistance by Eamelas against giving up what it had won and against giving in to the British and Greek government demands. Eam was squeezed. December was a forced reply. As the British say, Eam was cornered.
Churchill fought like blazes to get to retain Britain in the Britain's influence in Greece, and that's what had happened. And of course, I think Churchill too feared anything which had the sort of mark of socialism on it, because he thought anything was socialist was communist.
Churchill is one of the greatest agents of the victory against Hitler, and nobody can dispute his enormous contribution to the struggle against Nazism. But for us, the Greeks, he was the greatest tyrant, because he continued to keep Greece tied to Britain.
On February the 15th, 1945, the Greek government met with representatives of Elas and signed the Varkisa Agreement. The government agreed to an amnesty for all political crimes committed during the December fighting, and to remove from power all those who had collaborated with the Germans. In exchange, Elas agreed to surrender its arms. But neither the amnesty nor the purge of collaborators was carried through.
The
Varkisa Agreement betrayed the resistance. Our leaders tied us up, hung on foot, and handed us over to those who had collaborated with the Nazis.
The right choice would have been to abandon the conference and declare that they would continue the struggle outside Athens. We had this option. The whole of the Elas army was intact.
Within weeks, thousands of Elas partisans were imprisoned, and 2 years later, in the mountains, came the outbreak of the Greek Civil War.